Once I built a railroad, I made it run, made it race against time. Once I built a railroad, now it's done. Brother, can you spare a dime?
These are some of the familiar images and sounds that have come to symbolize America's Great Depression, the international economic disaster that began in 1929 with the crash of the American Stock Exchange and only ended with the onset of World War II. Except for the very rich, the ability to work, support a family, go to school, and just enjoy life came to a screeching halt.
You must have suffered the experience of tramping hot, smelly pavements day after day, going from one employment bureau to another. Let the hunger gnaw at your vitals until your head spins. You must go through the actual experience before you understand the hopeless state of mind.
The optimism of the 1920s gave way to uncertainty and cynicism about the future. By the early 1930s, there was 50% unemployment among Americans between 16 and 24 years of age, 5 million youth. In desperation, families and individuals left home in search of work and sometimes to escape harsh natural disasters. Many families fell apart.
Dad worked 10 hours a day for 6 days a week before the Depression, and things were fine. He wasn't a banker. He wasn't a machinist. He was a common laborer who put pieces of metal in a machine that went clunk. That's what my dad did, but he had his pride. After losing his job, their struggle slowly squeezed the life out of him. Take away a man's pride and he's skin and bones. He is nothing.
Barefoot in the summer, on into the fall. Church on Sunday to learn the golden rule. I've endured. How long can one...
By 1933, it was estimated that one-fourth of the nation's families had no regular income, and there was no significant relief in sight, not from the federal government, not from business, and not from private organizations or charities. Depression-era youth chose many different paths. For example, in 1933, 250,000 teenagers were traveling the rails and hitchhiking.
I wanted to stay home and fight the poverty with my family. I didn't have it in my mind to leave until my father told me, "Go fend for yourself. I cannot afford to have you around any longer." 18 months later, I was able to return and be of some help.
I was just another mouth to feed at home. I'd lighten my parents' burden if I took off. The quickest and easiest way to get out was to jump a train and go somewhere. We thought it was the magic carpet, the click of the rails, romance.
Poverty and home evictions soared in cities and rural areas across the nation. Between 1930 and 1935, about 750,000 farms were lost by foreclosure and bankruptcy. Families also lost any savings when banks failed. Even middle-class families sought relief available only from private charities.
Things went downhill. You lived off your relatives. You went to eat at grandma's until you hit rock bottom and went on relief. Those days, you didn't get a check in the mail. You took a little red wagon and dragged it around and waited in line. The relief people threw in food as if they were feeding dogs. It was the most humiliating experience in the world for a 14-year-old kid.
Oh, if you ain't got the do-re-mi, friend, if you ain't got the do-re-mi, you better go back to beautiful Texas, Oklahoma, Kansas, Georgia, Tennessee.
A turning point came with Franklin D. Roosevelt's election.
So first of all, let me assert my firm belief that the only thing we have to fear is fear itself. nameless, unreasoning, unjust...
Workers and young people were up in arms, pushing the new president to remedy the situation. His New Deal programs helped unemployed workers and their families. They created health and welfare programs aimed at infants and children, and work and education programs aimed at teenagers and young adults. These measures did not relieve all hardship, but for the first time, the federal government took responsibility for the welfare of its citizens.
In May 1933, I was one of the many jobless, disillusioned young men who trooped wearily into a Civilian Conservation Corps reconditioning camp. Not knowing, and not particularly caring about the future, we put on our GI clothing and tramped half-heartedly into the forests and fields to plant and cut trees and build dams.
The Depression spurred many Americans, especially young people, to act. In the early years of the Depression, students organized against war and agitated against racial injustice and the rise of fascism in Europe.
On April 6, 1934, I stood on the steps of Columbia and took the pledge. On that same day, 25,000 students at schools and campuses across the country took a solemn oath not to fight for our government in any war. But 3 years later, I climbed the Pyrenees into Spain to take a pledge to defend the Spanish Republican government in its life and death struggle against Franco, Mussolini, and Hitler. In defending Spanish democracy against fascism, I felt I was fighting for my country, and yes, fighting for that very government which I earlier had vowed not to support. But it was the rise of fascism that brought us to our senses.
The unbearable circumstances of the Great Depression endured for many long years, as did America's runaway teens, radical students, and other unemployed youth. But at this time, the very notion of childhood was changing, and important questions were being asked. Were kids losing their very childhood? What would become of so many young people raised in such poverty and with such hopelessness? Was the federal government ultimately responsible for the welfare of its young? What would all of this mean to the future of this nation?